It needs to detect Pearl Harbor by air.
Ask not what your country can do.
Kennedy has been shot.
One small step for man.
All these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
In 1998, the people of Paris began to count in public the remaining days of the 20th century. The countdown sign was mounted on what had become a monument to the technological progress of the 1800s, the Eiffel Tower. When it was built as the centerpiece of the Universal Exposition of 1889, Gustav Eiffel's construction was the tallest in the world, a symbol built with sweat and pig iron of how high man could reach.
Ignition sequence start.
Lift off.
Now, when man has gone to the moon and his machines have reached beyond that to Mars, science and technology have given us new ideas of the possible.
Yeah, everything looks good here.
In the early 1960s, the Canadian philosopher Marshall McLuhan suggested that advanced communications would shrink the world into a global village. Nothing has proved McLuhan's point quite like the internet. Through the internet, any kind of information is available to anybody, anywhere, at any time.
Yeah, I'm going to check my mail, and I'm also going to check my portfolio of my stocks. And you just log it into the computer, and it'll update every single day on the market, see how your stocks are doing.
Developed for military purposes during the Cold War, the internet went commercial in 1990. Today, information crosses national and ideological borders in a twinkling and links people in a worldwide web.
Sometimes you even can find some friends through internet. I found some in Australia.
The internet is on a scale of inventions that changed everything, probably somewhere right after the invention of language. It is an incredibly powerful tool. The internet works equally as well in the middle of the third world as it does in the middle of Wall Street. You have a device that for the lowest possible cost can reach anyone on the surface of the earth.
So every day, the edge of the internet expands outward into new space, new territory.
Vince Cerf is one of the internet's inventors.
I think back to the end of the 19th century often now, imagining what must it have been like for someone sitting in 1898. Very close into the future, Kitty Hawk coming in 1903, Einstein's paper in 1905. What is awaiting that person is a transformation of the way we live. So here we are, sitting on the threshold of the 21st century. Imagine what Kitty Hawks are just on the other side of that threshold. I can hardly wait.
Science and technology have taken us on quite a journey through the century. Young Americans cannot remember a time when the automobile, the telephone, movies, radio, and television seemed revolutionary. And many older Americans are still mystified by the landscape of the internet. In this concluding episode, we'll see how advances in communication technology have transformed the way that Americans see their role in the world, their government, their ideas of democracy, and certainly their popular culture. Through Through the century, America experienced the national triumph and the personal tragedies of two world wars, Korea and Vietnam. Near the beginning of the century, American soldiers fought in the war to end all wars. And yet, as the next century got closer, they were still fighting. 2 weeks before New Year's Eve, the United States had once again bombed the capital of Iraq. It was the second time in a decade that American bombs and Iraqi anti-aircraft fire had lit up the night sky over Baghdad. The first time in January 1991 marked the beginning of the Gulf War, precipitated by the Iraqi leader Saddam Hussein. In August 1990, he had invaded the oil-rich next-door kingdom of Kuwait, once part of Iraq.
This will not stand. This will not stand, this aggression against Kuwait.
Kuwait was gone. It became clear we were going to have to dispatch American troops to the Gulf and make sure the invasion didn't go any further.
President Bush put together an alliance of more than 24 countries and started to move 500,000 men and almost 4 million tons of equipment halfway around the world to Saudi Arabia.
The whole world had come together to save these countries that continued to ignore the lessons of the past, ignore the promise of democracy. They were going against the prevailing will of the entire world.
Many Americans believe that this country was fighting a war to make the world safe for democracy, as it had in 1917, when President Wilson sent troops to Europe. When the United States entered the First World War, the country's military strength consisted of 50 planes and enough ammunition for only 9 hours of bombardment. At the other end of the century, when over there meant the Persian Gulf, the United States was the greatest military force on earth. And after the humiliating defeat in Vietnam 20 years earlier, President Bush was ready to use America's overwhelming power. For a month, so-called smart bombs rained down on Iraqi targets. The technology would have been science fiction to people at the turn of the century, but the purpose of bombing hadn't changed much since the First World War.
In the First World War, there was the first exploitation of aerial bombardment of civilian populations. It was haphazard as a function of the technology of the day. But it worked to terrorize a population and to try to destroy commercial and political centers of power.
And so it did in Baghdad. Within a few days, parts of the Iraqi capital lay in ruins. As it turned out, smart bombs weren't always so smart after all. Like their low-tech predecessors, they killed civilians just as effectively as they showered death on Iraqi soldiers who shivered in their bunkers. Drier, but probably no less fearful than the soldiers in World War I.
At all times of the day, from morning till night, there's a huge sound of machine guns, bombs, planes in the air. The shelling practically never stops. They go to maybe a yard from you, maybe 100 yards from you. It comes splash right at the feet and they're blown to pieces.
By February the 15th, 1991, the Allied air raids had destroyed one-third of Iraqi armor, and still Saddam Hussein refused to leave Kuwait.
The prestige of the United States had been put on this. And frankly, the prospect for the future at the end of the Cold War had been put on the line.
The coalition geared up for a ground assault to liberate Kuwait and secure its oil supplies. General Powell wanted to rally worldwide public opinion to the Allied cause.
I needed something that would essentially say to the American people and to the troops and to all of our allies and to our enemy, all watching instantaneously in television, real time, something that would grab them.
Our strategy to go after this army is very, very simple. First, we're going to cut it off, and then we're going to kill it.
cut it off. The Pentagon restricted the flow of information, turning the 1,200 reporters in the Gulf War into a virtual propaganda machine.
If George Bush changed any minds in Baghdad tonight, they were not.
If you demonize the enemy, if you say that you're in the presence of the devil, it shouldn't be at all surprising that millions of people thought that very substantial celestial forces were on the side of the good.
Saddam Hussein did what he could to fulfill the popular role of devil. On February 23rd, as the ground campaign began to actually liberate Kuwait, Saddam Hussein set fire to more than 700 oil wells.
As we moved out and as we got closer to the border, you could see this large, dark cloud that was sitting over Kuwait. And as we drove under this cloud late in the afternoon, it was like going from day, or literally was going from day into night.
American soldiers were on their way to Kuwait at a confrontation with the Army of Iraq. They'd been told this was the fourth largest military power in the world.
I had a shortwave radio that I could listen to the BBC on, and you know, there was all kinds of reports for probable casualty figures, and that definitely was on your mind.
But there was little Iraqi resistance.
They would exchange a few rounds, maybe for show or for pride, I don't know, and then their hands would come up, the flags would come out, and they would come looking for someone to surrender to.
We realized what a disorganized, discouraged, demoralized force we were fighting as a result of 30-odd days of air campaigning, and the Marines were in Kuwait City in short order. This was not just a test of America. This was a test of the international community. It was part of our effort to show a united front to the Iraqis.
Troops from Saudi Arabia were the first to be greeted by overjoyed Kuwaitis. And on June the 10th, 1991, in New York City, 4 million cheering people honored the American soldiers with the largest ticker tape parade in American history.
Americans are looking to celebrate the notion of the Persian Gulf War being a good war and a war that didn't hurt anyone except the bad guys. The Gulf War was a big hit.
Since the time that American troops had returned from World War I and another generation of American soldiers came home from the Gulf War, the United States had grown from a minor player to the globe's only superpower.
We are number one and number two is number 12. But at the time, we saw that there was a new world of some kind emerging, and a term we used at the time, which is not in favor any longer, the New World Order, because the new world doesn't appear to be that orderly.
For freedom-loving Americans, a fundamental question has always been, how much influence should the government have? During the century, the answer has gone from one extreme to the other.
This is the Dandy Williams Show, along with
Phil Thomas,
Crystal Waters,
Ryan O'Brien.
Rock 100.5 The Cat, it is the Rick and Brad radio program. Good-looking morning. Should be probably about 70 for the high today, but a good-looking day, sunshine.
Oklahoma City, April the 19th, 1995.
That day started like any other. I was out at our training center where we had training as I'm a hostage negotiator.
I was going to stop and visit with my girlfriend that morning and have coffee, and on the way into work, I just decided to go ahead and head on to the office.
Priscilla Salyers worked for U.S. Customs in Oklahoma's federal building. Across the street, the Oklahoma Water Resources Board was holding its weekly meeting.
Receive information regarding
everybody, let's get out of here. Now! What's the electricity line?
We just had some kind of
The federal building had been at the center of the blast.
All of a sudden, it got very, I felt a jolt. My head hit, and I felt this jolt on my cheek, and everything got very quiet. I started falling forward, and I kept fighting and trying to sit up, and I didn't know what was happening.
In the force of the explosion, the fifth floor, where Priscilla worked, collapsed. Unconscious, she fell straight through to the second floor.
We got several injuries.
Let's get that area from below. Let's concentrate on the area that's roped off. We'll search it from down below.
Then I heard someone say, "We have a live one here." And I'm listening because it sounded like they were way off in the distance. But the man actually took my hand.
Police officer Don Hull was among the first to arrive on the scene.
Smelled death. That's what you smelled. Everything being pulverized and burned, and, you know, it was just death. I remember carrying out one little boy, and he didn't have a face. It was gone. I laid him down, and I told him I was sorry.
...168 people were killed, 19 of them children under 5. There was a daycare center on the building's second floor. Many Americans believed instinctively that the Oklahoma City bombing was the work of foreign terrorists. They were wrong.
Let us let our own children know that we will stand against the forces of fear. When there is talk of hatred, let us stand up and talk against it. When there is talk of violence, let us stand up.
2 years before the tragedy in Oklahoma City, federal agents had attacked the armed compound of a religious cult known as the Branch Davidians. More than 80 people were killed in an assault which ended a 51-day standoff played out on national television. The government action deepened the hatred of federal authorities held by Timothy McVeigh, a Gulf War veteran, and Terry Nichols, the two Americans who were later convicted of the Oklahoma City bombing. Radical extremists aside, many Americans do feel that their government has become something of an omnipresent and intrusive big brother. At the beginning of the century, Washington, D.C. represented little more than an abstract authority. Back then, government levied no taxes, issued few regulations, and offered no safety nets. It was survival of the fittest. But it became hard for even the fittest to survive when the stock market crashed in 1929 and signaled the country's economic collapse.
Our family felt the depression immediately. My father couldn't get a job. There was no unemployment insurance. There was no Social Security. There was no welfare. It was the end of everything.
Many people were waiting in soup lines for a bowl of soup and a piece of bread, and whole families, mother, father, and children, with nothing to eat and no place to spend the night. It was pitiful.
So many people felt that we were in danger of a revolution because there were many people who felt the government should do something and the government was doing nothing.
Strikes and protests were spreading. A revolution was averted when Franklin Delano Roosevelt became president in 1932.
Of course we spent money. It went to put needy men and women without jobs to work.
My father could get a job. So it was only $60, $65 a month. All those young men sitting around, they got work. I know it is said that it really didn't cure the depression, but it sure cured the depression in our house, you know. It revolutionized the perception of what government owes the people and what its role is.
That government should be responsible for its citizens' welfare was a revolutionary idea, but it helped to shape modern America, and it reached its apogee in President Johnson's Great Society.
This administration today, here and now, declares unconditional war on poverty in America.
My mother, she sit me down at the table and she laid out all of the bills in the house. And she laid out the water bill and the gas bill and what we plan to buy groceries. And she said, this is all the money that we have. One day, a community organizer came to our door to share information about the programs. They wanted to give you some exposure to culture. We obtained our first airplane ride or to see a play or the opera. The Great Society and the programs of the Great Society made you feel special. They wanted to encourage you, to let you know that you're important and that you can make it.
There seemed to be a government program for every social need. Many people benefited, but the government grew enormous, and so did the tax burden on the middle class. Those who had had enough saw a champion in Ronald Reagan. He vowed to reverse the trend started by President Roosevelt.
I believe it is clear our federal government is overgrown and overweight. Indeed, it is time our government should go on a diet.
Without giving up their benefits, Americans wanted to reduce the size and influence of federal agencies. Similar to the beginning of the century, a time when people had fewer taxes and government was less obvious.
The pendulum swings back and forth. There's a time when people look to the government to do a lot, and then there are times that they want the government to get out of their lives.
What people expect from their government stayed in flux throughout the century. It is one of those constantly evolving principles which influenced President Roosevelt when he called American democracy a story without an end. In 1903, the social philosopher W.E.B. Du Bois wrote, "The problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line." Every decade since has proven him right. Stone Mountain, Georgia, has its own version of Mount Rushmore, a monument honoring the leaders of the Confederate side in the Civil War.
My aunt, she was instrumental in that carving being on the mountain. They got up money to start it. It is magnificent, and when I stand there and look at it, I nearly have tears in my eyes because they were wonderful men, and it was something they thought they were doing that was right.
They believed in white supremacy. That was their philosophy. It was just a way of life in the South.
In 1915, when the Ku Klux Klan announced its rebirth, it did so in Stone Mountain, Georgia.
My uncle worked for the Grand Wizard of the Knights of the Ku Klux Klan. And as a child, I had the privilege of being carried to his home. And he treated me very nice.
For every year until 1990, the Ku Klux Klan held a rally in Stone Mountain on the Saturday before Labor Day.
And they would go up and down our streets, and they would just be blowing their horn, and dust would be just everywhere. And we'd be saying, oh, there come the Ku Klux. Here come the Ku Klux. It was fascinating and amazing to us as children. They was covered all in white, and the only thing that we saw as children was these little round things where they saw out of their eyes. And they used to burn a cross on the mountain.
The fruits of democracy.
It was just remarkable, and they had the loudspeakers turned up loud enough, and we could sit on the porch and hear everything that they said. It was anything nigger. It was everything nigger. That was that thing.
Part of integration, the out of which will come a conglomerated, the latter mongrel class of people. Both races will be destroyed in such a movement.
The methods are brutal, they're terroristic, and they are thugs.
Chuck Burris grew up in Louisiana.
Stone Mountain, to people of African descent who didn't live here but had heard about it, was a place of terror and fear. Not only to people of African descent, but to Jewish people, to Catholics. It basically stood for white Anglo-Saxon Protestant male-dominated society.
Every minority group in this country's had to fight for itself, but none so long as African Americans. As they struggled for basic constitutional rights, they were faced with the terror and the dizzying contradictions of segregation.
We'll be demonstrating here until freedom comes.
In the 1950s, black Americans began to push more fervently for their civil rights. The response resembled a new kind of civil war.
And I say segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation.
And we even had the governor of Alabama, George Wallace, spewing forth the politics of separation and dissolution of our unity as a nation. So I saw elderly men and women and children fire hosed and beaten and having dogs attack them, sicked on them by the police because they wanted to register to vote. They wanted to drink out of a water fountain in a public park. They wanted to be able to sit at a lunch counter like everyone else. Simple things in life.
Black kids being beaten up in the South, there was nothing new about that. What was new about it was that it was filmed and people saw it. When you see the blood running out of someone's head for no other reason than they are asking the United States government to obey its own laws, then it becomes a national or an international event. There was a very simple reason for why so many things happened so quickly in the early 1960s, and that reason was television.
Let freedom ring!
In 1963, civil rights leader Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. led a march on Washington. He spoke to a crowd of more than 200,000 people.
So let freedom ring!
It was so many black people there. But then it was so many white people that was going to be part of us accomplishing this freedom.
Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania. But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia.
I was just overwhelmed. Tears just started flowing down because that let me know that I was going to be a part of that freedom that was going to take place, that Moses had arrived for the black people, and we were going to be led.
Free at last! Free at last! Thank God Almighty! We are free at last!
But more than 30 years later, not much has changed for many African Americans. On October the 16th, 1995, 400,000 African-American men came from every state in the Union to the nation's capital. Dion Warner, a lawyer, made the journey from Houston, Texas. The gathering was organized by the Nation of Islam leader, Louis Farrakhan.
The real evil in America is called white supremacy. Because the idea of white supremacy means you should rule because you're white. That makes you sick.
I'm certain that there were many people who felt as though there would be some negative repercussions from having all those black males in one place at one time. And I think some of that is because what they see on the news every day, when they see people getting arrested or people doing drugs, are black men.
Black man, you don't have to bash white people. All we got to do is go back home and turn our communities into production. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. All we got to do is go back home and make our communities a decent and safe place to
live.
It
wasn't a march that said we hate this march. It really was about being positive about ourselves. So it was very important that we began to start working on making ourselves a healthier part of this society. And so the Million Man March was a shot in the arm to black men.
Hi. State your name.
Chuck Burris.
In 1997, there was another boost when Chuck Burris was elected mayor in the former Klan stronghold of Stone Mountain.
It was surprising to people all over this country that a black person could be elected mayor in Stone Mountain, Georgia, a real southern city. The reason was he was the best qualified candidate.
I knew that it was going to change. I didn't know whether I would live to see it change.
The very antithesis of what the Klan stood for has come to pass. I've seen demographic forecasts that indicate that the majority of America and by the year 2050 will not be white Anglo-Saxon Protestant.
To the flag of the United States of America.
In the 21st century, our destinies are linked together. So we've got to find the ways to bridge the gap, to link arms and attack problems and not attack each other.
Throughout the century, the press and later radio and television and the movies have sometimes blurred the line between the public and the personal, between entertainment and real life. By the 1990s, popular culture had become almost synonymous with celebrity culture.
Well, celebrity is one of the most remarkable phenomena of the 20th century. The human being as entertainment. Real life has become an entertainment that challenges and often supersedes conventional entertainments like movies and television and radio and trashy novels. And we are all performance artists in and an audience for a grand ongoing show that never ends. And I think we see this, you know, in dramatic form with the Monica Lewinsky scandal.
In 1998, President Clinton's relationship with Monica Lewinsky, a White House intern, snowballed into a constitutional crisis.
It has all of these wonderfully melodramatic elements: sex, power, money, dry cleaning. I mean, that the public loves this as an entertainment. But they don't want it to have any consequences.
The presidential soap opera, come crisis, fixated audiences everywhere. Overnight, Monica Lewinsky leapt from obscurity to worldwide celebrity.
Hey, don't touch her.
Hey, pal, get your arms off her.
Where did all of this obsession with scandal and gossip and celebrity begin? And I believe clearly there was a taste for this a long, long time ago, and it's not necessarily a 20th century phenomenon. But I think that the expansion of it in the 20th century was the product of a former vaudevillian who became a gossip columnist, Walter Winchell.
In the 1930s, Winchell's weekly radio show had an audience of 50 million people, two-thirds of the adult population.
White House people and Republican senators held three meetings.
Winchell, who spoke in a way that no other human being has ever spoken, but was remarkably effective in what he did. He's highly dramatic. He was really an actor.
Walter Winchell invaded the privacy of the rich and famous, and he turned gossip into news. The most famous man in the 1930s was Charles Lindbergh, who'd flown solo across the Atlantic in 1927.
I watched a cavalcade of cars going by with Charles Lindbergh in the lead car, and I caught a glimpse of him. Might have seen him for 3 seconds or something like that. It was the highlight of my life.
In 1932, Lindbergh's baby son was kidnapped and killed.
I can still remember hearing the newspaper boys on the street shouting the headlines that night. They used to actually say, "Read all about it, Lindbergh may be kidnapped." And then, of course, it was immediately extrapolated on the radio.
Walter Winchell covered the trial of the kidnapper, Bruno Hauptmann.
It made headlines every day for weeks and weeks on end. It was the thing people asked each other about.
Walter Winchell, more than any of the 100 photographers and 350 journalists, turned the proceedings in Flemington, New Jersey, into the entertainment blockbuster of the time. An enterprising sheriff sold tickets to the courtroom where Hauptmann was sentenced to death.
The O.J. Simpson trial is the only trial in modern days that could compete with the Lindbergh trial and the Lindbergh kidnapping for national attention.
211. We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant, Orenthal James Simpson, not guilty of the crime of murder in violation of penal code section.
Well, now look how far we have come. The interest in celebrity would go over the line of reason and become a sort of a stupid obsession in the American mindset.
Celebrity is not an American invention. It's just that America had the money, the mass culture technology, to put into making celebrities. So we've gotten a kind of monopoly on that process.
To us, America represented it was the other place that if you could only get there, it was like Camelot.
The Rolling Stones first toured the United States in 1964.
And after we arrived, there was enough of a welcome for it to be very encouraging, especially the female element.
And stardom in America meant worldwide recognition. A year later, they were superstars.
Music and all its directness and all this shit, right? Which is all very true, but everyone's told you that. But the thing was, there's a whole other thing going on in fashion and clothes. So you can relate to all this this otherness of it, just chic of it, just cool of it. All this imagery is very important.
The artist Andy Warhol took that imagery and he made instant icons of the famous, from Marilyn Monroe to Mick Jagger to Chairman Mao. Warhol quite literally transformed celebrity itself into an art form and coined one of the century's most quoted clichés. In the future, everyone will be famous for 15 minutes.
This whole experience is not easy for me.
I've called it Deborah Thornton Day. This is a day when my wife...
I do have to go. It's like a rehearsal I have to go to. And
there is nothing more democratic than the notion of celebrity. We live in a society where we can celebrate people who've really accomplished nothing, but who are nevertheless, on the other side of the glass, on the other side of that television tube.
Lorena Bobbitt is coming out of the courthouse now, and so the people who have come to support her, over 100,
they are in
this
special
cheering.
Status, this exalted status. Well, celebrity performs some of the traditional functions of religion. We love celebrities. We worship celebrities. We give celebrities everything. We genuflect before celebrities. Princess Di is a perfect example of someone who attained a kind of godlike status.
Diana was always treated as slightly dim-witted and a problem by the royal family, and she was loved by the people. She was a sympathetic figure. I admired the work she'd done with AIDS. I admired the work she'd done with landmines. I mean, people knew about that kind of thing.
They couldn't help it. Diana's every move was chronicled and broadcast to the world. Prince Charles may have made her a princess, but the media had made her something even more desirable. They made her a celebrity. In September of 1997, millions of people lined the streets of London to be part of the funeral procession for the people's princess. The funeral for Diana, the Princess of Wales, was the decade's great television event. Its sad evocation of youth and beauty and promise, so tragically cut down, appeared to touch so many people.
I was really surprised at how caught up I got in her death and the funeral. You know, I pretty much watched as everyone else did. And I think there's just something horrifying and so touching about someone taken at the height of everything.
At the other end of the century, in 1901, people had lined the same streets, watching the same unfurling of British tradition, when the British Empire mourned the passing of Queen Victoria, and with her, the 1800s. The world changed more between those two funerals than it had in the 1,000 years before Victoria gave her name to an era. As Britain and its empire dominated the world of the 19th century, the 20th century would become America's. And as democracy gathered strength around the world, America itself experienced what one historian calls a middle-class revolution of dignity. It could be found not only in the grand arena of politics and policy, but in the everyday lives of ordinary citizens.
History isn't just about generals and politicians and wars and social issues. It's about the whole mix of the human experience, and should be. It's about medicine and music. It's about love and money. It's about good times, bad times, about people you never heard of, places you never heard of, certainly about failure, sometimes about success. It's human. It's about life. And what makes it so compelling, I think, is that it's about the two great mysteries, people and time. The great theme in American life is that we are ordinary people, but we can rise to the occasion and do the extraordinary. That's true. True today. True as it's ever been. And should be in time to come.